He looks quite like a monster in battle, but in negotiations, he's very dignified. And I remember talking with this ruler, and I said, you need to let the land go. You need to let the people go. And he said, why? Why should I do that? He said, everyone is enjoying a wonderful experience under my rule. People are living longer. He even showed me some actuarial charts of how much better people were doing under his rule and how happy they were under his rule. And I said, well, that's because they don't know what the previous ruler was like. All they know is your rule and not anything else. That's why. And he said, well, that may or may not be true, but people still want me upon the throne. And I said, okay. But I think that it's wrong for you to rule because you've enslaved our land in eternal night, in eternal winter. This land, it never changed from darkness. It was always dark in the land. It was always winter. And then finally, he said, well, that's a reasonable argument, but you'll have to convince the people because all of them want me on the throne. And then the dream ended. And I thought about that for a while, and it reminded me of a passage in The Desire of Ages. And those of you who are following the dream can almost certainly see its implications. This is in the chapter called The Victory, page 130. When the tempter offered to Christ the kingdom and glory of the world, he was proposing that Christ should yield up the real kingship of the world and hold dominion subject to Satan. This was the same dominion upon which the hopes of the Jews were set. They desired the kingdom of this world. If Christ had consented to offer them such a kingdom, they would gladly have received him, but the curse of sin, of eternal night, with all its woe, rested upon it. Now, I would ask you this question. I believe that the reason why Satan still holds sway in this world is because we don't want to go home. I believe it is not dependent upon God. I think God has wanted to come, we know, from the prophet since shortly after 1844. But I think what God is waiting for is not for any more suffering, any more world wars or anything like that. He's waiting for us. And certainly you can have the kingdoms of this world and you can be happy with it, but it is a world of eternal night and eternal winter. And the reason why we don't want something more is because we don't know any different. We've never lived in a different world. And I say this as a young person because I've heard many people, I don't know if you've ever heard young people say this, well, Tim, I don't want Jesus to come before I get what? Married. We want the kingdoms of this world, don't we? We want what Satan offers us. But the problem is he offers you a kingdom that is enslaved in eternal darkness and eternal night. And so I pray that you with me will join me in that assault against his kingdom to restore the kingdom of Christ. And I pray that you in your heart would want that better country that God offers you. Before I begin, I am going to kneel one more time and ask God to be with me. Loving Father, I pray right now that I would be hidden and that you would be seen and that I would not speak my words, but that you would speak your words through me to your people. In Jesus' name, amen. Someone asked me this morning, they said, before you came to speak with us, have you ever heard of Steps to Life? And I said, why, yes, I've actually heard of Steps to Life. And they said, is it good or is it bad? And I assure you that it is good. In fact, it was so good that for many years, the Steps to Life Bible studies, I don't know if any of you have seen them, at the end of each study, there's a picture of Jesus at the end, and he's kind of very sad, and he's wearing the crown of thorns. And did anyone ever see that series of Bible studies? That was the only series of Bible studies I would send to people when they would often contact me after an evangelistic series or a presentation. Those were the only series of Bible studies I would ever send them. And I've sent them as far as to Scandinavia, to Finland. For many years, that's the only Bible studies I would recommend. So it was very positive. In fact, this is a picture where there may be a couple of people that you recognize. What I'm going to share is the key to understanding the Bible. And I had an experience in a country, and it is quite possibly the most vivid and clear explanation of how to understand the Bible I have ever learned. I was invited to go to, does anyone know where this is? You probably don't, I'm not sure. But this is in front of our hotel. There's several of us here. And the reason why I like this picture is because I think it's an illustration of heaven. Heaven is composed of every nation, kindred, tongue, and people, right? People worship God of every color, of every race, of every nationality, of every language. And we almost have every race and kindred and tongue represented, I think, just in that picture. We enjoyed time together as a group, socially. We ate out together. But most of our work here was done in a very primitive fashion. We were basically teaching the people, usually in the open air. There weren't really any churches for us to go to, except for at some occasions we would be present in a building, in a church, but there are really no walls, no separate classrooms. There's just one big room, and we'd all teach different topics about health and the Bible. Occasionally we had some nicer facilities, but most of the time it was just a chalkboard and some desks and benches. At one point in time, there were so many needs on our group is that we divided ourselves up into smaller delegations. There were about 30 of us in the group. And what they decided is that they would send people out, how many at a time? Two and two, according to the suggestion of our Lord. However, this was in Peru, as many of you might have guessed at this point again. And of course, not everyone could speak Spanish. So they would send out one Spanish speaker and one English speaker. Now, when they came to sending me, they decided to do something different, which I felt was a little unfair. They said, Tim, since you can read, write, and speak fluent Spanish, we're going to just send you by yourself. And we're going to send you to the most rural church in northern Peru. In fact, this church had no floor. It had no roof. It had just rebar sticking out around the walls with some just makeshift thatch sort of coverings. And when I got there, I found that Peru was like most of the developing nations that I had been to. How many of you have ever come to speak to a developing nation, to a church there? Now, when you come as the speaker, are you expected to just present once? No, no. In fact, it is implied that you will give the Sabbath school, the sermon, the children's story, the AY, the Vespers, and any other possible speaking slot there is. Is this not true? Now, if they find out you can sing, then you'll also be giving the song service, the special music, and everything else. Now, unfortunately, I can't sing, so at this church, it was pretty much myself for the greater majority of the service. And if you've ever been to developing nations, does the sermon end at 12? No. Does church consist of merely Sabbath school and church? In fact, it goes all day. This is an all-encompassing sort of service. Amazingly enough, if people didn't show up at church, do you know what would happen? Church would come to them. There would be a delegation of elders that would come to their home and have the entire church service right there, whether or not they were willing to come. That's the way they do it in a lot of these developing countries. And I think that's why they have a lot better results than we do here in North America. But I can tell you one of the things that just moved me deeply was when I had finally finished Vespers and it was sundown and it was dark, and I mean dark. There was one light in the church, that's all they had, and that was kind of at the front, is when the sun was completely down, there was Sabbath had gone, we had finished having the prayer, then they had the announcements. They didn't have one announcement during the Sabbath hours. Can you believe that? That is profound, brothers and sisters. I mean, and these were reasonable announcements. They weren't like, well, we're going to have a yard sale or something like that. It was nothing secular about it at all. They waited till the Sabbath was over to make the announcement of the book they were going to study for prayer meeting for the next quarter. And so what they did is they raised up a book. It's not this book. But they raised up a book, and I don't know if any of you have ever seen it. It has kind of some art from the 60s, and the title of the book is Cosmic Conflict. Did you see that book? There were several versions of the Great Controversy that they had created to perhaps make it a little bit more winsome for the general public, and many of them really didn't do so well. They didn't sell well at all. So they found their way into these developing countries because they were a lot cheaper. And so they held up this book and said, this is the book we're going to be studying for next quarter's prayer meeting. I said, wow, you guys are going to be studying the Great Controversy. That's fantastic. And two of the church members who were sitting next to me, they said, oh, Tim, you don't understand. We want that book more than anything else. And I was thinking to myself, wow, this is really not the greatest version of the Great Controversy, at least not from a graphic standpoint. But they really want it. I said, well, I guess that's fine. You're going to get it next quarter, so you don't have to worry. And they said, you don't really understand, do you? We have to buy all of our books. We have to buy our Sabbath school lessons. We have to buy any of our materials for anything. We have to buy our own Bibles, our own hymnals. We can't afford to buy that book. I said, you're kidding. They said, no. I said, well, how much is the book? They said, oh, it's so expensive. If we worked from now until the beginning of next quarter when it started, we wouldn't have enough money to buy even one of these books. And both of these church members were thinking of ways that they could somehow save or sell things or do whatever. They said, oh, I don't know what I would do. Their names were Corey and Heidi. And I said, well, what would you be willing to do? And they said, we'd be willing to do anything for this book. I said, well, what if you had the book? What would you do with it? And they said, well, we would study it every week. We would have the chapter read. We would share it with our families and our friends. Well, we would do anything. But you see, Dr. Riesenberger, this is way too expensive. I said, well, how much is it? Tell me. This is probably 10 soles. And the denomination in Peru is the sol, which is sun, interestingly enough. But that comes out to about a dollar in our money. And I thought, wow, this is just a dollar. And so what I did is I went back to my hotel room, and I talked to one of our group members who was in charge of the literature. I said, do you have a Great Controversy in Spanish? She said, I have plenty of them. I said, can I have two of them? Sure. Here's two of them. So what I did is I took two Spanish Great Controversies and I brought it to the pastor of this church. Well, it wasn't just that church. He was the pastor of about 13 other churches in northern Peru. And I said, do you know Corey and Heidi who are in the such and such church that's developing? You guys don't even have a building? He said, yes, I know those two church members. I can bring them the book. This is very nice of you. Are you sure you want to give it to them? I said, yes, absolutely. No cost. Tell them to have it. Tell them enjoy it. And I pray that God blesses them as they read it. And so I didn't go back to that church again. I was pretty much at a different place every day, every weekend as well. And 3 days later, we had the opportunity to do clinic in one area. And when it was announced that we were going to have free medical care, all of the people from the surrounding villages just converged on this area. Hundreds and hundreds of people who wanted medical care, and it was just so busy. And finally, I just said, look, some of you are nurses, some of you are people who are studying lifestyle medicine or in medical missionary courses. If you can figure out what's wrong, just treat the people and do the best you can. And if you can't figure it out at all and you have no clue with what's going on, then send them to me. Because I was getting inundated with people who wanted to see the medico and not someone else. So as I was doing this, I had found that many of the surrounding churches in the area had sent some of their members to support us. And I could see that Corey and Heidi were helping with the hydrotherapy station. And so I came up to them and I said, did you get the book that your pastor, I gave to your pastor? And they said, oh yes, thank you. And I said, well, have you started reading the book yet? Oh, absolutely, we are already done for what's coming up for next week. We've already read all those chapters. We've shared them with our family, shared them with our friends. I said, really? You've already done that? Oh, yes, absolutely. We're reading it together as well. I said, well, that's great. And I was very moved. In fact, how many of you have ever given someone a book as a present? Many of you. So quite a few of you. Now, would you say that there are ever times when that person, when you ask them if they've read the book, if they've ever had to tell you, well, and maybe as soon as they get it, they'll read the preface or the epilogue or something like that and say, yes, I haven't finished reading it, but what I've read has been a great blessing. Have you ever heard them say that? When you really know they haven't read much of the book. How many of you ever received a book? How many of you? No, don't answer that question. But I can tell you, most of us, when we get a book, we don't start reading it right away. It's very rare. And it's a great honor, I think, that someone actually does read a book within 3 days of you giving it to them. It's quite rare. But I can tell you that the reason why I was very shocked and surprised was not the fact that they had started reading the book, or even the fact that they had even started sharing it or read it with their families. The most surprising fact is that this is Heidi and Corey. Heidi is the smaller one, and she is awaiting the arrival of her two front teeth, if you turn the lights down a little bit. Heidi is 6, Corey is 9. Now keep this in mind, this is the great controversy we're talking about. So Heidi, the younger one, actually had to have her mom read it with her, not so much to share it with her mom, but that she couldn't understand some of the larger words in Spanish. And when I realized this, brothers and sisters, I realized that I did not understand God's word. And I did not love God's word at all. You see, because when a 6-year-old and a 9-year-old, instead of wanting to play with toys and dolls and other things, want to read the great controversy more than anything else, that's very humbling to me. You know, it had been several years since I had gone through the great controversy. And I can tell you what I did when I went home. I went directly home, and I went to the great controversy, and there are several chapters in the back, starting with The Origin of Evil. Very, very intriguing chapters. And I read that section 7 times, and then I read through and went through the whole book twice. And I said, God, have mercy on me. I don't love your word. I've got to be kidding myself if I think I love your word. I mean, these are two children who would give anything they have to just have the opportunity to read about you. And these two little children in Peru taught me the greatest thing that is necessary to understand the Bible. Please open your Bibles to Psalm chapter 119. Psalm chapter 119 and verse 99. This is the first key. There will be 3 keys to understanding the Bible. And you've actually seen all 3 of the keys already, just through this story. But we'll share a couple scriptures just to bring it home for you. Psalm 119, verses 99 and 100. This is David speaking. He makes quite a claim. He says that I have more understanding than who? How many of my teachers? That's quite a claim. But why is that? For thy testimonies are what? My meditation. What does it mean to meditate on something? Absorb, yes. What else? Thinking about it all the time. Anything else? How many other things are you doing at the same time when you're meditating on something? You are focused on one thing and one thing alone when you are meditating on one thing. Have you ever seen people who go, om, om? That's transcendental meditation. That's a different thing than Christian meditation. But how many things are they saying? One thing. It's called a mantra, actually. They're only focused in on one thing, and that's, I guess, the word om or whatever it is. And their mind is focused in on just one thing. Now, it's interesting. I have a friend of mine who is a young person, like myself, and she often tries to have deep conversations with her mother. But her mother is of such a personality that she's always doing something. She is never quiet and never still. And in fact, when my friend is trying to talk to her mother will actually start doing the dishes or running the blender while she's trying to talk to her. Would you say she's focused in on what my friend's trying to say? No. And oftentimes, brothers and sisters, that's what we do with God, is it not? We are sitting and trying to do multiple things at once. You know, we're in the car, putting on the makeup and trying to eat a bowl of cereal and listening to the Bible on tape. Is that really meditating on God's Word? Not to say that it's bad. I have all the Conflict of the Ages series and the entire Bible in my car on MP3, and I constantly listen to it. That's wonderful, but that doesn't take the place of being still, being alone, having everything quiet, and having you and God's Word for that quiet hour of meditation in the morning, does it? It doesn't take the place. When you are focused, when you are meditating on something, you are focused on one thing and one thing alone. I can tell you that the pastor that baptized me, his name is Doug Tilstra, some of you might know him, but he is a very, very intriguing pastor because when he talks to people, he will not look at his watch ever, he will not answer his phone, he will ignore any beeping that he gets, he will not look over at someone else as they're walking by. He's only focused in on one person at a time. And I can tell you that moved me more than anything else about him, is that when he's talking to you, he's talking to you. He's not focused in on anything else. And I think that the reason why we don't understand the Bible is because we do not seek it at the loss of all other things, like Heidi and Corey did. We are distracted with many other things. Luke chapter 10, verse 42. Luke chapter 10 and verse 42. Very common passage. Mary and Martha were there at the house with Jesus and his disciples. And what was Martha doing at the time? She was getting the food ready. Not a bad thing, right? Nothing wrong with having good food. And I praise the Lord. I was just telling the cafeteria, this is the best food I've ever had at any camp meeting. And I don't say this just because I've been to one camp meeting. I have spoken at several, maybe dozens, if not even hundreds of different places. And I can tell you that this is clearly the best food I've had at any camp meeting. And I praise the Lord for that. But the purpose is not the food in our lives, right? The most important thing is not that. Luke 10:42, what does Jesus say? You know, I can just hear the pathos in Jesus' voice. He says, Martha, and he probably paused a little bit as she's still moving around, and then he says one more time, Martha. You are what? Careful and about how many things? Many things. But how many things are needful? One thing. And what did Mary choose? That good thing that shall not be taken away from her. Mary knew that although there were many good things in life, there was only how many things that were necessary? One. And I can tell you that ultimately, at the end of time, only one thing will matter. And that is going to be God and what you have done for others in his name. In fact, my last presentation is going to be the only question God will ask you in the judgment. So make sure to stick around for that one as well. The amazing thing to me is that we have placed a different value on understanding the Bible. We have placed value on books and people and degrees, when really that is not the key to understanding the Bible. The first key is to seek it at the loss of all things. Psalm 119, verse 100, if you still have your finger there. Psalm 119, verse 100 is the second principle as we transition. Psalm 119, verse 100. What does David say? I have more understanding than who? The ancients. Who are the ancients? Those people with the really long beards down to here that are 100 and who knows how many years old. People who have been around so many times. David is claiming to have more understanding than who? The ancients. But why? Why? What does he do? Because I have what? Kept thy precepts. It is not merely meditating on God's word that gives understanding. What else do you have to do? You have to do it. To know and not to do is not really yet to know, is it? To have understanding of God's word, there has to not only be a focusing in on God at the loss of all things, but there needs to be an execution of what you learn. John 7:17 is a very, very important principle here that Jesus himself told us. Jesus tells us in John 7:17 a very critical part of understanding the Bible. What does Jesus say? If anyone what? Will what? Do his will, then what will happen? Then he shall know. Isn't that interesting that the key to understanding is doing what? Is doing it. Now, I'd like to give you a very striking illustration. I'm wearing a tie today, and I did this on purpose. Does anyone know what's on this tie? What does it look like I have on the ties? I have windmills. Actually, I have a lot of windmills. So what country do you think this was given to me in? Holland, yes. I was actually speaking in Holland, and I was presenting some evangelism, but I was also presenting some of the health message. And I was in Holland, and I was presenting that you cannot always trust the medical literature to steer you in the right direction. True science will always be in harmony with revelation, but we do not always have true science in our journals. I believe it is a matter of time before science will catch up with the spirit of prophecy, and eventually it is. It's doing a little better job. But I shared an article from the Journal of the American Medical Association, which is basically our premier journal as physicians, in 1935. Now, that wasn't that long ago. 1935 was just still in this century. And this article shared that smoking cigarettes was good for several health conditions, such as asthma. Now, would you say that smoking is good for asthma? Well, we recognize now that the cause of all pediatric asthma is usually secondhand what? Smoking, certainly. And so I had presented this as a point that the medical literature does not always steer you the right direction when it comes to true laws of health. And after this presentation, I had a physician actually come up to me, and he came up with a nurse as well. And he said, "Dr. Riesenberger, I need to have the reference for that article. I need to have a copy of that article. Can you send me a copy of that article?" And I thought to myself, well, I guess I could. And I said, sure, I could do that. But see, I wasn't going to be seeing him. I said, "Are you going to be here tomorrow for the next presentations?" He said, "No." And I said, well, what I can do is I can maybe send a copy to your wife here, and then she can get it to you. And he kind of looked down at the ground as I said that. Because, friends, this woman that he was living with, this nurse, was not his wife. And he was a member of the Seventh-day Adventist Church. And I felt like saying, "Brother, why don't you let me hold on to the article for a while? Marry this woman that you're living with, then you can share the health message after that." Because what we do, brothers and sisters, is we try to be so meticulous in other areas because we know that we're not obeying some other area in our lives. It is easier to be very stringent in areas of our life that we don't have problems with than to sacrifice and crucify the flesh in the area of our besetting sin. I have told people many times about the health message. And this is coming from a person, I am not only vegan, I'm vegan organic with a juicer at home. So I'm like way at the end of the spectrum, and I'm not saying y'all have to be like me. But I tell them, I say, friends, it's more important what comes out of your mouth rather than what goes into your mouth. And that's a direct quote from Scripture, is it not? I believe in the health message. I'm a physician. I love it. It's great. But friends, deal with the bigger issues in your life first. rather than being so meticulous. It's so funny. Whenever I present the health message to any Adventist audience, there's always a question, and I don't know why this question comes up every time. People always want to ask me about mushrooms. Dr. Riesenberger, we need to know about mushrooms. Have you ever heard people ask this question? And I finally just want to tell them, folks, just make your own decision about the mushrooms. I mean, I can present some stuff that I do know about it, but deal with other things. Like, you know, this is audiences that are eating meat and eating at night and drinking alcohol and things like this. I think the mushrooms are like way, way down here. Deal with the big issues first. And I think that we don't understand that. We don't understand that God is not going to give us any more light in whatever area it is in our life until we, what? Obey. Until we do what he has asked us in the fundamental areas, like what you say, how you treat people. Those are the things that we need to take care of first. And after that, after we obey what we do know, God will help us to understand what we don't know, right? That's the key to understanding the Bible. I want to share a passage with you. This is in Desire of Ages. Actually, I'll start with Steps to Christ. Steps to Christ, page 127. Whenever men are not in word and deed, seeking to be in harmony with God. What does it mean to be in harmony with something? Exactly. To be the same, to be similar. Then however learned they may be, they are liable to err in their understanding of the Scripture, and it is not safe to trust their explanations. Isn't that hard? Whenever men are not in word and deed seeking to be in harmony with God, then however what? However learned they may be, they are liable to err in their understanding of Scripture, and it is not safe to trust to their explanations of Scripture. That's a very powerful statement. That was Steps to Christ, page 127. So it doesn't matter how many letters you have after your name. I think I have 7 letters after my name. But that doesn't mean anything. That means zilch-o. If I am not seeking in what? Word and deed to be in harmony with my Master in heaven. And it's not safe to trust to my explanations. And I tell people that. You can look up everything I'm presenting yourself. Don't trust to what I say. Desire of Ages, page 370. Successful work for Christ depends not so much on numbers or talent as upon pureness of purpose, the true simplicity of earnest, dependent faith. I can't think of a better picture of simplicity and earnest, dependent faith than these two children. Because you know why it is so surprising for us to see them do this? Well, turn in your Bibles to, I believe it's the book of 1 Corinthians, and it's chapter 1, I believe it's verse 25. Well, actually, let's go up a few verses. First Corinthians, chapter 1, verse 19. For it is written, I will destroy the wisdom of the wise and bring to nothing the understanding of the prudent. Where is the wise? Where is the scribe? Where is the disputer of this world? Hath not God made foolish the wisdom of this world? For after that, in the wisdom of God, the world by wisdom knew not God, it pleased God by the foolishness of preaching to save those that believe. And you go down to verse 25, because the foolishness of God is what? Wiser than men. And the weakness of God is what? Stronger than men. Here's a critical verse that follows. For you see your calling, brethren, how that not what? Not many who? Wise men after the flesh. Not many what? Mighty, not many what? Now, I can tell you that I'm very thankful that the word is not many instead of not any. Because I'm very educated, and if it said not any, then that would exclude myself, Dr. Grossball, several other people. But it says not what? Not many. So very, very few people that are educated, that are mighty, that are wealthy, understand what God is all about. Now, why is that? That's right, absolutely. When people have their M divinity, or whatever degree, they tend to trust more in who? Yes. Or let's say someone came up and gave a great sermon, and they say, well, of course, that's Dr. John Grossball. You know, he's a doctorate in theology, and we tend to place the reason that the quality is good on their intellect, right? Their degrees. Now, the amazing thing is, and this is the reason why God chooses foolish things and weak things, is when you look at Heidi and Corey and their fervor and devotion to God, this is a six-year-old. Who gets the glory? Is it Heidi? Is it the fact that she's gone to Stanford University or Harvard or anything like that? Well, she hasn't even gone to school yet. Who do you know is working? Who do you clearly know gets the glory here? It's Jesus Christ. Because there's no way that a six-year-old could have that. There's no other alternative than to say it's God. Whereas if you have someone who's learned, who's very intelligent, who's very talented, very smooth in their presentation, there is a tendency to give the glory somewhere else, is there not? But you see, this is why God chooses children, why God chooses the weak things of the world to do stuff like this, because there's no way that we can miss the illustration. It is so clear that anyone can understand that it is God that is working here. I'm going to share another illustration with you. Have any of you ever had the illustration used where you shrink the world down to a small little size and then you make comparisons about that? If you took the world and you shrank it down to about 3 inches in diameter, you know, basically the size you can put it in your hand, what's the highest point on the earth? Does anyone know? Mount Everest, sure. What's the lowest point on the earth? Well, the Dead Sea, or people could say, if you count the ocean, there's a little further, but... So the Dead Sea, or Death Valley, or if you want to use actually a landmass, compared to Mount Everest. If you were to take the world, and you were to have it in your hand, and you were to run your hand over Mount Everest, and the Dead Sea, and Death Valley, do you know what you would feel? You'd feel nothing. That's right. The earth would be smoother than a pool ball if it was that size. And who has the whole world in his hands? God does, doesn't he? So the mighty of us, the mightiest, the greatest saint compared to the least sinner is what to him? It's all the same, isn't it? Because he is so much bigger and greater than all of us. And that's why to God, it doesn't matter how smart you are, because compared to him, you're not. That's the point. Because the weakness of God is what? Is stronger than men. And the foolishness of God is what? Wiser than men. In other words, if there could be a part or a little corner of God that was weak, it'd still be stronger than you. And if there was an area of God's brain somewhere in the back that just wasn't quite the same as the rest of his brain, which there's not, it'd still be smarter than all of us combined. And that's the reason why that you don't need to go to school to understand the Bible. And I'm not knocking education. I think education's great. I've gone to a lot of education. I think it's helpful, but it's only helpful if the other things are in place. And that's number one, if you seek God at the loss of all things. Number two, if you obey what you understand. It's not rocket science, brothers and sisters, just doing what God has revealed to you. And the last part is also, I think, critical to understanding God's word. Turn with me in Luke chapter 6. Luke chapter 6 and verse 38. Luke chapter 6 and verse 38. Give and what? it shall be given to who? To you. Good measure, pressed down, shaken together, and running over shall men give into your bosom. For with the same measure that you meet withal, it shall be measured to you. Do you know what the best way to learn a subject is? That's right. It's to teach it. Now, sometimes we're in different situations. I was in a hospital doing my internship, which is the first year after medical school. And I was asked to put in a deep central line, a subclavian line, in a patient that was critical at the moment. And I explained to my senior resident, I said, well, I've only put in three of these right now. I'm not really that comfortable doing this. Would you mind maybe showing me, and then maybe I can do it? He's like, no, just put in the line, Riesenberger. And I said, well, isn't it supposed to be see one, do one, teach one? He's like, no, in this hospital, it's do one, and do one. And so they were not an advocate of the gentle approach of teaching. But it is true. If you teach others, you yourself learn better than anything else. I can tell you that after I come back from presenting, I can meet someone on the street and I can present the whole thing by memory pretty much, because I have now taught it and shared it with you. What was the first thing that Heidi and Corey did after they received the Great Controversy? They shared it. They shared it with their parents. They shared it with their family. They shared it with their friends. They were so excited to have this precious treasure given to them for free that they had to share that precious treasure with everyone around them. And I can tell you that that is quite possibly the most critical part of understanding the Bible, is sharing what you do know with those around you. I'm going to end with a very important concept, which I believe is not only important for understanding the Bible, but to be saved. How many of you liked to climb when you were young? I loved climbing. How many of you have ever seen by a sidewalk a wall? And the wall starts off low, but it gets a little higher. Have you ever seen those kind of walls? I have. And I loved those because my dad and I would be walking on the sidewalk and we'd come to the wall and I'd get up on the wall and he'd be down there and I'd go higher and higher and higher and higher to eventually to a place where it was about 6 feet off the ground and the wall would end. Now, at the end of the wall, what do you think my dad wanted me to do? To jump down into his arms, because, you know, it's quite high up there. And so, what do you think I would do? I would jump down. My dad's a pretty big guy, and so he wouldn't have any trouble catching me. But as I got a little older, maybe 5, 6, 7, and I would come to the end of the wall, what do you think I would do then? That's right. I would go down myself. Now, was it because my dad still couldn't catch me? No, he could probably still catch me. He's a big guy. He could probably catch me when I was 13 or 14. It wouldn't matter. But as I got older, what changed? I became more dependent on who? Myself. That's right. And that is why, brothers and sisters, that a 6-year-old and a 9-year-old can understand God's word better than you and I. Because we trust who? We trust ourselves. We trust ourselves rather than God. And that is a normal part of human nature in growing up, but it is lethal to your spiritual life. The more dependent you are on yourself and your own abilities, the less likely you will ever be saved. Matthew 18. Let's take a look. Matthew chapter 18, verse 3. Jesus tells us this is critical not only to understanding the Bible, but to salvation itself. Matthew chapter 18, verse 3. And he said, verily I say unto you, except ye be converted and become what? As little children, ye shall not enter into the kingdom of heaven. You see, because a child is dependent. It's humble. It's teachable. And that's why God can save little children a lot easier than he can save you and I. Believe me, brothers and sisters. But I praise the Lord that God had mercy upon my soul And he sent me two children in Peru to learn what really it is to understand his word. I'm going to share another passage here at the end. This is in Testimonies to Ministers, page 119. God can teach you more in one moment than you could learn from the great men of the earth. Isn't that impressive? God can teach you more in one moment by His Holy Spirit than you could learn from the great men of the earth. This is another passage from Great Controversy, page 599. Understanding of Bible truth, understanding of what? Bible truth, depends not so much on the power of intellect brought to the search as upon the singleness of purpose, the earnest longing after righteousness. You may not have a PhD. You may not have any formal education at all. You may not have even gone to school, past high school, even elementary school. But you can understand the Bible. In fact, you may be able to understand the Bible much better than myself, who has gone to school, because you're not dependent on yourself, but you're dependent on Jesus Christ. And I pray that as you open God's Word, that you would remember the little toothless grin of a six-year-old, Heidi, deep in Peru with her friend Corey, who was nine, and that you would remember that the key to understanding God's Word is to seek it with all your heart at the loss of all other things, to obey what God reveals to you, and to share it with others. Because ultimately, friends, although we are not all children, unless we learn the lesson from Heidi and Corey and become as little children, we can never be saved and never understand God and His truth. Let's kneel for prayer. Loving Father in heaven, I thank you so much for your mercy to my soul, for teaching me through little children in Peru what it means to truly understand your word. Help me, Lord, to let go of what I know and to trust in what you know. Help me, Lord, to depend on what you can do much more than what I can do. I pray, Lord, that everyone that can hear my voice would embrace this truth, would let go of their own preconceived ideas, and become as little children as they approach your word in the Bible and the spirit of prophecy. May we know, Lord, as well, that just as you can teach Heidi and Corey, you can teach us as grown-ups, that we too can let go of our own confidence and have strong confidence in you and what you will teach us. I pray, Lord, that we will not only keep these truths to ourselves, but that we would share with those around us, with our family, with our friends, with our co-workers, so that we too might gain a blessing in sharing. Lord Jesus, we love you, and we thank you, and I just pray that this Sabbath we might truly understand your word as never before. In Jesus' name.